pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Who's going to help me carry these now?
Thank you. No, that one's good. Why don't you take those buckets?
Do we have to take them here?
Only Steve that I've seen.
We have a number of presentations this evening. I'm sorry, you saw how we deal with Christmas unwrapping. I would like the following people to come up if they're here right now, please. Marcia Donahue, Steve Parkhurst, Jerry Petroselli, Jeff Van Fleet. Any of those folks who are here?
Scott Collins is in here, isn't he?
Just you, huh?
Just me.
No, you don't get them all. We'll flip for those. Steve Parkhurst has been the chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board, and that's the capacity in which we're recognizing his efforts this evening. We are giving him, now that he's no longer chairman, I'm not quite sure why we do this a little bit backwards, but now we'll give you a gavel to recognize all the times, hopefully, that you didn't have to use a gavel. Planning Board had some tough decisions to make under your chairmanship. You set good goals for the Planning Board. You followed through with those, you held a steady course, and the town is in your debt for your service in that capacity. We really, really thank you, and I personally thank you.
Thank you.
Now we have council reports and correspondence. Do we have anybody? Nobody has any reports of correspondence. Okay.
Well, actually, I have one thing.
Oh, Council Linnell.
My nephew was John Sullivan, tied for the state championship swim in the butterfly. Congratulations, John Sullivan. He's from Cape Elizabeth.
Okay. Thank you very much. Councilor Reed, I know that we are looking for applicants to serve on our pool committee. Can you tell us when the deadline for that is, please?
The article ran in the last Cape Courier, and Bill, do you remember what the deadline is since the town manager is busy?
For the 24th.
The 24th of this month.
All right. So there still is time, and I believe we have received a number of applications, but more are welcome by the 24th. I'm going to ask the clerk to give information on nomination papers.
Thank you. Currently, nomination papers for council and school board are available. We have 3 seats on the council and 3 seats on the school board. The deadline is Monday, March 24th in my office. Anyone interested in getting papers, please let me know. You would have to obtain between 25 and 100 registered voters of Cape Elizabeth to be nominated for the ballot.
Great, thank you. 24th is a busy day. The council on the evening of Monday, March 24th, will be having a discussion forum about paper streets. This is a time for those of you who have questions and concerns about paper streets, be they general questions, be they specific questions, to come and present those to the council. We will have, I believe, the town lawyer available that evening to take down questions. We are not going to be providing answers to specific questions about specific streets that night, but we need to know what the concerns are so that we can hold a public hearing later on to address them and to make appropriate recommendations about whether or not to terminate the town's interest of rights of way in some of the existing paper streets. So we encourage any of you with potential interest in a paper street to come and join us that evening. If you're not sure if you're next to a paper street or what the situation is, that's also an appropriate evening for you to come and ask. We will have some maps available. And if you just want to make sure ahead of time, you can get in touch with the manager's office. Good. Hate to volunteer too much. Councilor Jordan, do you want to tell about adventures we had over the weekend?
Is that the right way to put it up? No, I happened to go to Washington for the National League of Cities and attended a few meetings. I didn't go down quite as soon as the rest of them because I figured I had to serve lobster stew before I went down. I'd keep it hot, ready for the sewers. And it was a very interesting time. I attended two or three meetings there, and one of them was very interested about towers and the cellular phones that's going to come play in a big way in a few years. They laid out there's about 100,000 of them out now over the country, and they're increasing the average of 22,000 a year. So it's something to be thinking about as far as where towers should be located. One person brought up a point about them. They might come up with a small one that you'd have on your home. I suggested Scarborough and Cape Elizabeth and South Bowling should get together and plan for one central one. I don't know just how big the area will cover, but I think it should be worked in that direction as a community type, similar to RWS, the way they worked with. I attended one where Representative DiMicci made a pitch, and it was very interesting in how they figure things out down there. I don't think we do it that way, but if you want to come in and show a deficit but tell the people you're reducing it, he explained how it was done. You just put another name on the increase, and like Medicare, and put another name on the increase and say they reduced Medicare. It's interesting to talk to those people. You seem to get a little bit on the inside of how business is done. And as I come away, I question about every one of their statements. Then I went with another one, another meeting on what kind of goals and what have you, and how people should plan ahead on what is you look for in the future. And quite interesting to hear from other people and how they think in those directions. And I had to sit with the manager and listen to your vice president give a good speech, but Michael told me he told part of it before. How he was president for 5 minutes. I guess that about covered my trip. You probably got a more detailed one because you're a better secretary.
Not tonight. I came back and immediately went to work last evening. I think one of the highlights for me that Councilor Jordan shared was after we had our session yesterday morning and we were with Representative Shays from the state of Connecticut, and he commented that the House was not in session. Would we like to go on the floor of the House of Representatives? There were about 30 of us in the room, and we all, of course, said yes, so that was quite a treat. And Councilor Jordan remarked on the way out through the cloakroom when he saw the chairs lined up there that, well, you knew where the work really got done when they're sitting out back in the cloakroom having their chats. We had some nice insights into national politics and had some worthwhile sessions. I will be preparing a report for the council on some of my experiences in my training seminars down there. Anybody else for reports and correspondence? Okay. We have minutes from two meetings, meeting number 15, which was held February 10th, our last regular meeting, and then we had meeting number 16, a special meeting held on March 5th. I'd like a motion on those, please.
Move approval.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. At this point in the agenda, every regular meeting, we have a time for citizens' discussion of items that are not on the evening's agenda. If there is anybody who would like to take advantage of that, would you please come to the microphone, give us your name and address, and give us a short discussion on something not on the agenda? Yes, sir.
My name is Bob Schumann. I live in Delano Park. There is a product that is legal to sell in this town, and it's legal to use, but it's not legal to dispose of. And I would like the town to address that problem and schedule some method to get rid of paint thinner. Paint thinner is used to clean brushes. Anybody who paints their house with oil paint has got to use it. The recycling center won't take it. I called Safe Harbors on the recommendation of the DEP and another company, I forget what the name of it was, but it's a competitor. They'll take it away from me. If I deliver it to them, they'll take it for $150 a gallon. I'm not going to do that. What we're faced with, and I think everybody probably recognizes this, if we don't find a legal way to get rid of this, people are going to take illegal ways. And I don't want to do that. As an example of how hard it is to do, 10 years ago, before I moved to Cape Elizabeth, I was living in another state, and I had some there that I had collected over the time in that house. And I went through all this series of phone calls, and I called everybody and his pet dog. And the best, believe me, the best recommendation I could get when I told them I was moving to Maine was, why don't you take it with you? So nobody wants to address this problem. I understand it's an expense for the town to get rid of it. The best recommendation or suggestion I've had here is, do you have any friends in South Portland? Wait till they have a toxic cleanup day and take it to your friend and let him take it to their disposal system. That's really not a good answer. I'd like the town to address that. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who has an item that's not on the agenda this evening they'd like to address? All right, seeing none, we will move on to our consent calendar item. We have one, two, three, five, three items on consent calendar. Item number 150, burial fees for Riverside Cemetery. Item 151, a pole relocation on Shore Road. Item 152, approval of proposed Fort Williams Park events, British Car Show on September 7th, with a rain date of September 14th, Engine 1 Art Show on August 31, with a rain date of September 1, and Family Fun Day on June 21, with a rain date of June 22. Is there anybody who wants to remove any item from the consent calendar? No, two more, excuse me. Item number 153, dismissal of a nuisance claim at 537 Shore Road, where a building is now being renovated. And item number 154, referral of proposed budgets to Finance Committee. Is there anybody who would like any of those items removed from consent calendar? Okay.
Go ahead. I yield to the lady.
Councilor Reid.
I just had a question with all the people that are in the room, if any of the people that were here had any comments on those items. I haven't received any phone calls.
Thank you. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. Just wanted to mention very briefly the burial fees as a result of a bid process. The increases vary from up to approximately $25. They are for 2 years. Our burial rates are still substantially below other cemeteries. The pole location on Shore Road is across from Delano Park Entrance 3. The reason it's being proposed by the utilities is because there's a voltage problem apparently within Delano Park, and the placement of this pole would help to increase the voltage in Delano Park. It's not on the Delano Park side, though. It's on the opposite side. The Fort Williams events have all been held before their routine. The nuisance claim was filed last year against the property that is the Basics, used to be the Basics store. I think most everyone's familiar with it, and probably everyone's driven by there and see the great progress that is being made. And would like to talk for a brief moment about the municipal budget that is being proposed to be referred to the Finance Committee. It does propose for the municipal side of government a 1% decrease in the tax rate for municipal services. The continuing operating budget is to the dollar, the same as it is this current year, absolutely no increase. There is a new position and department for the management and maintenance of school and town facilities. There was quite a bit of citizen concern a few years ago when the buildings, particularly the school building, started to deteriorate of why it wasn't being looked at, and the town needed to do a better job there, and this is to address that. There's adherence to a long-term capital improvement program for the community. There's an increased effort in road paving and maintenance. I think all of us, probably driving to the meeting this evening, experienced the need to address that. There's a cost of living adjustment for non-union employees and an assumed savings and benefit cost. The town is a little rich in its, what it's been providing for health insurance in particular, and that is something that we hope to address this year. The tax rate overall for municipal services is 2 cents per thousand less than it was 6 years ago, which I think would take a lot of people by surprise that municipal taxes have actually gone down. Beyond that, the town council is receiving a very large budget book, which anyone in the public can review. There's also will be available tomorrow a summary of the budget for anyone who wants to see it. The town council will be meeting next on April 5th, which is a Saturday, to do a full-day review of the municipal budget, and if anyone's interested in attending that, you're welcome. We'll also have a more detailed schedule for that day sometime between now and April 5th. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Councilor Jordan.
Yeah, I have a question on the burial fees.
Certainly.
I just would like to know whether we just go at this by increasing it $25 a year, or is there anything as far as costs of running the cemetery? Why do we have to go up? That's what I want to know, and I don't have the information here.
But you know, I said they went up an average of 25. You see in the information before the council, some went up less than that. A couple of fees went up more. The reason they're going up is because this is a privatized service that we bid out, and those that bid on it bid a higher amount. In the past, we had added $50 to all of the charges from the private firms. We actually, in this particular proposal for burial fees, have reduced that in half for in most areas. So we're actually reducing the town overhead portion to absorb some of the increase from the bidder. apparently successful bidder.
But do you actually have some figures on what it costs?
Yes.
I don't mean you've got to have them right here to throw them out tonight. I would just like to see them.
Yes, we have full amounts on what all the bids were for. There's different bids depending on the time of burial, whether it's a cremain or a full burial, and we do have all those exact amounts, not only for Riverside Cemetery, but also for Calvary Cemetery and for Forest City and Evergreen Cemeteries.
Well, I just don't feel we have to keep up with them. That's the idea.
No, we have no intention of keeping up with them. We just want to recover our cost for the burials, and we have tried to becoming more productive on our end. On our end, we've actually reduced our cost in our portion of the total burial fee.
Councilor Jordan, I think the best cost we can come up with is what the private contractors would charge us. We don't have what it costs them other than what they've put forth in their bid proposals.
Okay, I'll let it go at that for now.
Okay. I'm not sure your question was being answered, but I'm not sure we have the answer that you're looking for. Just want to make do the best.
I don't think you do.
I don't think we do.
Just, if I might, for 1 minute, the burial fee for regular adult burial weekday proposed for this year is $275. That compares to Calvary, if it's before noon, at $500, in the afternoon at $550. It compares to Forest City and Evergreen at $400. So we remain substantially below those fees.
We just had a rush of applications here. Get ready tomorrow. Councilor Jordan.
But that don't mean we have to keep up with them and get up to them.
No.
No, it doesn't.
I thought that's what we was working here, $25 a year.
That's what the bid was. And if that's what we get for bids, and that's apparently the low bid,
okay,
that's what we go with.
Sure.
Councilor Linnell.
I'm glad I got mine before the price went up.
Okay. Councilor Cogsell.
Yes, I would like to make a motion to move the consent agenda.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. We have three public hearings this evening. We're not usually blessed with this large an audience, and I very much appreciate your joining us. What I would like to do is separate this more or less into two public hearings. I think we can combine the new zoning ordinance and the new zoning map to some extent. They do have to go hand in hand for some components of it. I would like to separate out the public hearing on the proposed amendments to the current zoning ordinance relative to wetland provisions. What I would like to do is ask how many of you are here to speak only to, or listen, as it were, only to the public hearing comments on the current zoning ordinance relative to wetlands. I see one tentative hand. All right. How many of you are here to speak or listen to comments on the new zoning ordinance or zoning map? Thank you very much. I think I know what order we'll do those in. We will do the... Can I do it that way?
Ask for motion.
Do the public hearing.
Can we do public hearings either way? All right. Let us first have discussion then. We will put off until secondary the discussion about the new provisions in the wetlands ordinance that are being proposed for the existing ordinance and for the new ordinance. Let us have a discussion about the new zoning ordinance. And I would like to ask Councilor Cogsill to give us an introduction on this. Councilor Cogsill served as the chair of what has become known as ZORC, the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee.
Very good. Thank you, Madam Chairman. This is sort of the culmination of 2 2/3 years of work that began in July 1994 when we hired Evan Rickert of, which is now known as Planning Decisions, to guide us through this process. He was succeeded by Mark Arriman of Planning Decisions. The council appointed this rewrite committee so that we can make our disjointed ordinances user-friendly, internally consistent, and contemporary. The decision was to prepare this new zoning ordinance was part of the town council's goal for customer service and the recognition that our off-amended zoning ordinances needed a new format. In addition to the general reformatting task, ZORC was directed to implement the recommendations of the 1993 comprehensive plan. The state law requires that a community's zoning regulations must be consistent with a locally adopted comprehensive plan. At a workshop on September 26, 1994, the town council selected these recommendations, which ZORC should include in the provisions of the zoning ordinance. The committee was appointed with myself as chairman, John McGinty, Irv Chappell, Bill Jordan, and Dick Dahlbeck as town councilors, Janet McKay representing the Planning Board, Judy Dooley, the Zoning Board of Appeals, John Green, the Conservation Commission, and Alice Rand as a member of the public. The support staff, as I said, was Mark Arriman of Planning Decisions, Evan Rickert, who is now the Director of State Planning, and our ever-tireless Maureen O'Mara, town planner. We had additional input from all the other staff, Jerry Daigle, our town assessor, Ernie McVeigh, code enforcement officer, Mike Hill of our town attorney's office. And much identification and location of historic structures was done by Connie Murray and Lynn Jones of the Cape Elizabeth Historical Society. I would like to take this opportunity to recognize the tireless dedication and superlative caliber of the members of this committee. We held more than 32 meetings to discuss policy and review zoning ordinance drafts. In addition, the committee took a 4-hour field trip in December to look at cluster subdivisions and old small lot neighborhoods in Cape Elizabeth and the Portland area to supplement the policy discussions surrounding the RB zone and open space zoning. To supplement the scenic protection policy discussions, the committee also commissioned a study of economic feasibility of scenic protection through cluster development in the summer of 1995. All the ZORC meetings were open to the public, and detailed minutes of each meeting are on file in the planning office. Following the initial workshop with the town council and the planning board in September of 1994, a status report was sent to the town council in January 1995. Joint workshop was held with the town council and planning board to discuss the proposed RB district and open space zoning. Another joint workshop was held in November of 1995, which featured the scenic overlay districts and the scenic feasibility study. In advance of the advertised call-in show on cable channel 3, a complete copy of the draft zoning ordinance to that date was provided the end of January 1996. The first complete draft of the zoning ordinance was provided to the council in advance to the May 15, 1996 public forum. In August of 1995, the Cape Courier began publishing a series, a total of 9 articles, subsequently 10 with the last forum we had on the scenic provisions, describing the new zoning ordinance with emphasis on the policy changes recommended in the comprehensive plan. A public forum was held on January 17, 1996, featuring the proposed Great Pond Watershed Overlay District. Notice of this forum was mailed to the property owners in and adjacent to the proposed watershed overlay district. A call-in show was aired on Public Access Channel on January 31st of 1996. A public forum unveiling the draft zoning ordinance as a complete document was held on May 15, 1996. For this meeting, a public notice and copy of the applicable zoning text and map was mailed to all property owners in the proposed RB district, the proposed scenic area overlay district, and the proposed historic structures, owners of proposed historic structures. All 3 public meetings were preceded by comprehensive publicity efforts through the Cape Courier, the Portland Press Herald, Public Access Channel billboard, and the sign in front of the Public Safety Building. In addition to outreach to the general public, ZORC sought out input from specialized groups. In May 1995, the Fort Williams Advisory Committee was invited to participate in the redrafting of the Fort Williams District. The Planning Board provided informal comments on the site plan and the public access waiver regulations. The Zoning Board provided comments on the revisions to the conditional use and nonconformance sections. The Conservation Commission representative coordinated comments between ZORC and the Conservation Commission with emphasis on the Great Pond Watershed Overlay District proposals. In addition, comments from 3 Cape Elizabeth residents who have a working knowledge of ordinance and planning issues has been provided. Letters were mailed as a follow-up to all the members of the Comprehensive Planning Committee to notify that this product was ready for public viewing. The new zoning ordinance has been drafted with an emphasis, it's a long read, on consistency and readability. It incorporates new terms and concepts and implements major land use recommendations in the comprehensive plan. In many cases, revisions to the existing ordinance have been made to reflect what is the current custom and practice. During the deliberations, ZORC identified related activities that complement the policies in the proposed zoning ordinance, but which are not appropriately incorporated into a land use ordinance. ZORC is therefore making companion recommendations to the zoning ordinance in the areas of the Great Pond Watershed Overlay District and the Fort Williams District. The Great Pond non-regulatory recommendations are attached. Regarding the Fort Williams District, ZORC is recommending that the public comments be obtained regarding the Fort Williams Master Plan and any changes to it. A proposal for dealing with a waiting period prior to the demolition of historic structures as listed within requires a 45-day waiting period before the demolition could be completed. The current public access waiver standards have been completely rewritten so that lots on private roads which meet town standards and have sufficient frontage, will no longer need planning board review. A proposal for allowing contract zoning has also been included. The Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee is pleased to submit this ordinance for the town council and the public, and we are available to answer any questions as well as the town planner. So we have had a total of 8 joint workshops with the various boards of the town. The planning board held a public hearing in December of 96. We had a forum on the scenic ordinances February of this year with a Cape Courier article preceding that. The town council had a workshop on March 5th, and tonight we have our next public hearing.
Well done.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's a lot of history, a lot of good history. The council is very aware, and the council shares concerns that have been expressed about the scenic protection components of the zoning ordinance proposal. To that extent, the council has had workshop discussions. We've had a forum discussion for the public, a separate workshop discussion about it, and what the council decided to do along those lines was to establish a 5-person working committee, an ad hoc committee, to look solely at the scenic protection provisions of the ordinance proposal. That committee will be getting materials at the end of this week, and I'm hoping that they will be starting their meetings next week. We're kind of putting them on a fast track and asking for their recommendations back to the council by April 7th so that we may consider them at our April 14th council meeting. Is that when the council meeting is? I'm lost here. The members of that working committee, I'm trying to remember which pile I have that wonderful list, and I think we've got it here. The committee is going to be chaired by Ann Schenck. Committee members include Sonny Young, John Green, Ed McElhaney, and Carol Haas. We welcome your comments this evening on all components of the proposed zoning ordinance, but I just wanted you to be aware that there will be more specific attention paid to those scenic protection components. We want something more realistic than what we see right now in the proposal. The meetings of that committee will be public meetings. They will be open to you. I would suggest that you stay in touch with the town planner's office if you're curious about when those meetings are being held. And certainly if you have comments you would like to share with any of the committee members, please do so. But please keep in mind that we are asking them to be on a fast track and move that process along in an extremely fast manner. And we appreciate your help with that. And I personally want to thank those 5 who have generally very quickly agreed to give us that service. Look forward to the results of their work. What I'd like to do is ask people to come to the microphone. You don't have to come in any order of events, any order of discussion. We're not going to take one section of the ordinance and talk about that and then go to another section. So when you come up, please talk about any and all sections that you're interested in. Since we have such a large turnout, I'm going to ask you to please limit the length of your comments to 5 minutes, if not shorter. Shorter would be appreciated, but we're here to listen to everybody tonight, and this council will stay here and listen to everybody who wants to speak to us this evening. That's a good idea. One component of this proposed zoning ordinance is for contract zoning. I know there's a lot of concern. I've heard a lot of distress expressed about that. We have with us this evening the consultant who has worked along with the Ordinance Rewrite Committee and the town planner, and I'd like to have him give us a quick walkthrough, if you could, of what's entailed with contract zoning. Yes, you are the consultant. This is Mark Ironman from Planning Decisions.
The proposed ordinance that's under consideration does include a provision that allows for what state law is referred to as contract zoning. Essentially, it's a provision that allows the town council, through a review process, to I'm going to use the word negotiate the zoning conditions that apply to a piece of property in a way that may be different than other pieces of property. Traditionally, communities have used contract zoning to make the zoning restrictions more limiting than the general requirements that would apply within that zoning district. Someone comes forth with a proposal that might not otherwise be allowed, but through arrangements that limit the way the site's developed, hours of operation, those sorts of things, communities have found it a way to work to allow uses that might not otherwise be allowed on a way that's acceptable to the community. The ordinance specifically, and if anybody has it, on page 207, 208, talks about the kind of conditions that the ordinance envisions that the council might impose, physical development, number and types of uses, specifications for design and layouts of buildings, schedules, commencement and completion of construction, preservation of open space and buffers, provision for public access, protection of natural areas, contributions toward provision of municipal services, financial performance guarantees. Those sorts of things are envisioned as part of the contract zoning. Essentially, it's a device that allows the town some additional flexibility in return from some guarantees relative to the use of property.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, the microphone is yours.
This isn't working the way I thought. Why is this facing this way?
I turned it.
Turn it.
Oh, okay. Okay, it just seemed odd.
Sorry about that.
Thanks. Oh. My name is Mallory Haffenreffer. I live at 340 Ocean House Road with the rest of my family. I think the comments made about pulling the scenic overlay out for a quick and earnest review is something that the council should be congratulated on. And my hope is to encourage you to consider that tonight for this contract zoning issue. My family came here a year ago to speak at a council forum to express our concerns about the addition of contract zoning to the proposed zoning amendments and the comprehensive plan. We were worried then, and we are still worried tonight. My single interest tonight is to be sure that these kinds of changes are crafted with the idea of giving the average person in Cape Elizabeth a sense of safety. Many people here tonight, I think, feel that the town is at a crossroads in coming to terms with growth. We are expressing legitimate and sincere concern over what feels like an acceleration of change and development. We are afraid of losing the scale and the sense of small town, which might well be changed not by any one thing that might happen, but rather a series of events which, when combined, have an overwhelming and unfortunate effect which could be and will be irreversible. We are surrounded here by towns who have fallen prey to the whims of earnest developers who arrived and took advantage of a moment and left behind what we now see as enormous and permanent mistakes. Contract zoning can be used as a tool by good planners, and we have a good planner in this town, and responsible boards, and we have responsible boards in Cape Elizabeth. But sadly, it can also be used as well by those who want to use it as a tool to only further their own means and objectives. If people are worried and feel ambiguous about complicated decisions like these, it seems only sensible and fair to take very, very careful steps, maybe even a few more steps than have already been taken before making these permanent decisions. What might be these changes in regard to contract zoning? I think it would be a great idea to look at tightening the language of this proposal, clarifying what its purpose is in real terms and restate its relationship to the comprehensive plan. And I will interrupt myself right there and say that this afternoon, I went over and over and over it again. And I've talked with friends who are lawyers and friends who are town planners and friends who have lived here a long time, very intelligent people. And if it's really hard for us to unstrangle this language and understand it ourselves, I think maybe we could find language to clarify it to the average person who is not a lawyer, not a planner, and hasn't been working on ZORC for 2.5 years. Because it's very difficult to understand, and I think it could be clarified a lot more. At this time, it's very vague and general, and people feel it lacks safeguards it needs to prevent contract zoning from becoming a vehicle for people who want a way to bend and twist protections that are now in place strictly for their own gain. I would like to ask the council for the opportunity to offer respectfully a series of suggestions in writing which only seek to strengthen and clarify the purpose here. Some of these ideas include restricting contract zoning to specific zones here in Cape Elizabeth instead of allowing it to blanket all 12. Clarifying the criteria relevant to the approval of the zone by the town council. Clarifying the intent and procedures of the site plan review by the planning board, and adding some language which would put the burden of proof of meeting all of these squarely on the shoulders of any incoming developer. There are many other things to consider. My request is, could we not take a little more time and try to work together to craft this idea specifically to the needs and desires of our own small community? I believe in the end we really do all share the same goal, and that quite simply is to preserve the character of the town, ensuring that land use and development always remain consistent with a very well-crafted comprehensive plan, and in the end provide all of us with peace of mind. That's it.
Thank you. Do you have those suggestions in writing?
Yeah, I do. Back there.
Okay, good. If you could pass those to the planner, please. Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Peter Jacobs. I live at 44 Cranbrook Drive. And I would also like to speak briefly about the topic of contract zoning. There are many people here tonight, so I will be very brief. But I want you to know that I speak as a Cape resident of 11 years, as someone who has built and owned several homes on the Cape, as someone who has owned at one point a residential subdivision on the Cape. And I say that just to make it clear that I'm not someone who is against development per se, nor am I against progress per se. I do have, however, a very strong belief, very strong faith, in the virtues and the values of a comprehensive plan. Such plans are, by definition, designed with an eye to the whole picture, both in terms of the whole community and in terms of the long term. They are created, one hopes, dispassionately, objectively, and not on an ad hoc basis. By contrast, contract zoning presents the risk that decisions will be narrowly focused, that they'll be short-term in nature, and that they'll be ad hoc, one deal, as it were, at a time. The major risks posed by contract zoning, I would suggest, are several. Among other things, the potential for contract zoning impairs the certainty and the predictability that is afforded to buyers and builders by comprehensive zoning, with the possible result of lowering all property values on the Cape as a result. Also, as noted, the kind of ad hoc, let's make a deal approach that contract zoning permits runs the risk of ill-considered short-term decision-making, even assuming, and I do assume, the very best of intentions on the part of the decision makers who are considering the contract zoning in question. And so I join many of my Cape neighbors here tonight in urging this council to stick with the comprehensive long-term approach and to reject the notion of contract zoning. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Bruce Cogsall. I live at 336 Ocean House Road. I've been a resident of Cape Elizabeth since 1968. I appreciate the opportunity to address the council tonight. As most of you know, I do have an opportunity on a regular basis to address one of the members of the council. But I take special pleasure in being able to address all of you at one time. I have studied the contract zoning provisions at some length, and I think I finally understand how they work and what the consequences are for the town. And while I recognize that there may be some good features and some instances where contract zoning would be a useful and beneficial development tool for the town, on balance, I think that contract zoning will become a developer's tool and not good for the town. And with all due respect to your planning advisor, your consultant, this does more than simply give the town council the opportunity to negotiate zoning conditions. It does a lot more than that. And let's see how it works. First, there's got to be a finding that a proposed development is either unusual or two, in a unique location. Now, I don't know what kind of unusual developments this town is trying to attract here. There may be some, but I can think of a couple of unique locations that could be impacted by contract zoning. These two locations are Fort Williams in the Fort Williams zone and the Town Center in the Town Center zone. As best as I can determine, these are the only two areas of town that the council has already decided in the zoning ordinance are unique. Now, having made the determination that the project is either unusual or in one of our unique locations, you then changed the zoning classification. That's how it works. You don't simply negotiate conditions. You change the classification. You actually rezone a portion of the existing zone. Now, in order to do this, you must make a further finding that the use of the property proposed will be consistent with the comprehensive plan and with the uses otherwise permitted in the existing zone. Now, I'm not sure what consistent means. It could mean the same as, it could mean identical to, but it probably means compatible with. If it meant the same as or identical to, we wouldn't need this contract zone. So I think a fair interpretation is that the use, the new use that you permit, has got to be compatible with the existing uses and the existing permitted uses, and compatible with the comprehensive plan. Now, compatibility is not defined anywhere, and it's a matter of subjective judgment, which will vary with the person making the determination. Someone has to decide that the new use is compatible, and you can be sure that that decision is going to be influenced with some gentle persuasion from the developer. I also have to make a finding that the new zoning classification will promote the public welfare. Now, I assume that what is required here, although it's not clear, is that the new zoning classification and the new development will themselves promote the public welfare, and that the public welfare component can't come from some collateral agreement with the town, such as the developer agreeing to buy the town a new fire truck or provide a new baseball field. In other words, if we can't find the public welfare component in the reclassification itself, can the developer buy that welfare component? If that is the case, there's an awful lot of room for mischief in this ordinance. Now, I'd like to put this in context, and I apologize for taking so long. I'd like to put this in context by looking at the Town Center zone. This zone currently has a lot of protection built into the zoning ordinance. It's got prohibited uses, such as a drive-through restaurant. There are limitations on the types and sizes of businesses that can be permitted. There are performance standards. There are design requirements. There are limitations on the sizes of buildings and the bulk and the footprint of buildings. There are limitations on the heights and slopes of roofs. There are limitations on the types of materials that can be put on the exterior of the buildings. There are landscaping requirements. There are buffering requirements, to name a few. If we rezone for a particular developer, all these protections which we carefully crafted for the zone go away, because now the property is in a new zone. And what we get in place of these protections are whatever protections the developer and his lawyers negotiate with the planning board and the council. Now, I use the town center zone as an example, but this could happen in any zone, and the effect is the same. Now, I have a great deal of faith in our council, in our planning board as currently constituted. And I believe that this council and this planning board would do the right thing if some unusual development were proposed or if a development were proposed for one of our unique locations. But planning boards and councils change, as do the negotiating skills and strengths of developers and their lawyers. And I guess if I had the choice, I would stick with the certainty we have, rather than leaving this to individual negotiations every time a new developer comes to town. And I say this knowing that there are developers chomping at the bit to have this adopted so they can leap into town and get something approved that they would not otherwise be able to get approved. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd like to ask people to line up at least two or three along the wall. I think that'll help us move along more quickly this evening, please. If you could line up, anybody who wants to speak, let's have at least two or three waiting so we can, or you're all done? Is there anybody else who'd like to speak? If somebody else is thinking, please.
Yes, my name is Bob Tripler. I live on Trendy Road. And although Mr. Cogsill promised to be brief, I can be a lot briefer than that because I think he's said it all, and I just would like to add my voice to what he has said, not change a thing. Yeah, I could have written that myself. And it might save the council time this evening, perhaps, or a show of hands, how people feel about this contract zoning thing. I think it's, to me, in my mind, it resembles a little bit like the what they call the soft money in the fundraising and the politics, you know, to drive a truck through it. That's all.
Thank you, Mr. Tripler. I will take Mr. Tripler's advice to heart. It was also one of the next time-saving moves here. There may be some of you who would prefer not to come to the microphone to speak. And let us just get a sense to help out the council. How many of those here this evening are in favor of the contract zoning provision as it's written currently in the zoning ordinance proposal? That was overwhelming. It was underwhelming. How many would like to see more work put into the contract zoning proposal? You may have some agreement with it in theory, but you think what is being proposed right now needs to be reworked. Thank you. How many of you are philosophically opposed to contract zoning? Thank you. Those who would like to speak will certainly continue with the public hearing. They may have saved some of you from it. Trip to the mic.
Yeah, I'm Carol Fritz from 9 Hunt Club Road. I will change the topic a little bit. I have comments on two things. I know that you have received some negative comments on the scenic protection portion of the zoning ordinance. and that you're going to be working on that with a working group, but I want to urge you not to change the intent in any substantial way. I served on the Comprehensive Planning Committee that did its report. I think although the plan is dated 1993, I think we finished our work in 91 or so. And we did survey the community, and there was just overwhelming interest in protecting the views that we have in this community. One of the questions was, what are the most desirable qualities about living in Cape Elizabeth? One was the proximity to the ocean, two was the natural environment, and three was the physical attractiveness of the community. That all has to do with the scenic views of and what you see every day as you go about your work, go to school, go shopping, whatever you do, it's what you see in the town and the sense that you have of the community. 96% of the people said that they agreed with the need for strong controls for future development. 97% said that we should maintain existing scenic views of the ocean. And these are the things that we've said in this zoning ordinance. The scenes that we're saying we should protect are, I don't think anybody can disagree with. Views of the ocean, views from the lighthouses, views from Kettle Cove. I really don't think you want to lose these, and I don't think the people in this town want to lose these views. One of the prize things I keep in my records from working on past comprehensive plans, because I've been on two of them, is this map that showed the scenic nice things about Cape Elizabeth that you see marked in orange. This came out of the 1980 Comprehensive Planning Committee. A lot of these nice places that we like to look at are on private property. So this zoning ordinance doesn't include a whole lot of these views, but they're still great. So I don't think that what's being presented is something that's terribly strict, terribly overly protective. So I do want to urge you, it's taken a long time for this scenic protection zone, part of the zoning ordinance, to come to the council. It's been about 6 years, I think, and it is the number one recommendation that the comprehensive plan made to put protection of our scenic views in place in our ordinances. One of the proposals that I think you had at your workshop was the possibility of taking out the scenic areas section, the third section of this ordinance. And I would just like to urge you not to do that. Maybe some wording can be changed. Maybe we don't have to be recommending so much control over the architecture style of the buildings that are proposed. But by eliminating that whole section, you would be eliminating the opportunity to use transfer development rights, and that also, I think, would eliminate a good reason for having denser development in the new residential zone that you're creating in Residential B. So I would urge you not to fool too much with that scenic protection district. I just also want to make a couple of comments on contract zoning. I am opposed to contract zoning. I think if we have it, it's in essence saying that here is a way to get around the ordinances. If a developer can think up a good enough reason that we may change the rules over time. And I think it's very difficult for the public to keep up with negotiation that goes on kind of behind closed doors, not really behind closed doors, but I think we need to set down the rules, I think, on paper, and people know what they are, and that that we all play by the same rules on a level playing field, and I think you only do that if you have ordinances that you can count on from day to day.
Thank you. I do just want to clarify that nothing that is being proposed is being proposed to go on behind closed doors. I just think that's a bit of an unfortunate remark, and I know that wasn't your intent, but sometimes people hear that, and that's what sticks with them. There is nothing at all being proposed that would go on behind closed doors. This will all be public policy, public procedure, whether it stays in the ordinance or not. Yes, sir.
My name is Warren Heller. I live at 37 Ramble Road. I've lived in the Cape here for about 24 years. With this change being proposed, I got a little excited. I found out that a Florida development company or someone was trying to come in, and at Pond Cove, which we were talking about, is a rather restricted area, and he wants to, across from the farm stand area, he wants to build an area such as a shopping center twice the size of our present location, and also some large buildings similar to some of the Rite Aid down in South Portland. And after talking in my neighborhood, we got concerned about it, so suggested I go around and get a few signatures who were against any change of development of that particularly wooded area next to Town Hall. And I've already presented, I think, over 80-some names that you have received, the council has received, was given, I believe, to you.
Yeah, there was.
As I've been passed out to the people. This is just one small area in Brentwood East. And of all the people I called on, there wasn't a single person, a single one, that was in favor of a developer coming in and changing all this wooded area, ripping out the trees, putting in some new buildings. Most of the suggestions was, why couldn't the city build a park, a bike trail, a nature trail, something of that sort, rather than changing the complete scene of our local area? Now, if I picked up 86 names in just a short couple of days in my neighborhood, without one single person not wanting to sign it, what would happen if I went to the complete city and got a survey? It would probably be 99% would be against that. So please take that in consideration when you make those decisions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Hi, my name is Jeffrey Stevenson. I live at 8 Hampton Road. You've heard most of the issues that I was going to raise addressed more eloquently than I'm probably prepared to do right now, so I'll just briefly reiterate what I've heard the other speakers say. First, that our comprehensive plan zoning is one with clear rules, expectations, and I might add, an appeal process. The contract zoning reduces the process of negotiation, and you've heard many people state that we have less faith in the negotiating skills of any one individual or small group than in the codified rules of a comprehensive plan. With contract zoning, the visions of the town's interests will inevitably vary from individual to individual, and there is a consistency with the comprehensive plan that appeals to the people you've heard from, I think, for the most part tonight. I'd like to add one last item. Comprehensive zoning, it seems to me that there will inevitably be a perception from among the average property owners that those with deeper pockets and greater resources will wring some concession not available to the average person, and that is inevitably a prescription for acrimony in our public discourse, and still yet another reason, I think, to oppose contract zoning.
Thank you, sir.
My name is Jane Greer. I live at 66 Wells Road. I'm in the area of town which is going to be part of, I believe it's called the Scenic Overlay District. Just have a couple of brief comments and some very small items as part of that. As part of the wording, I believe it says that you're looking for the type of architecture that I think you're calling, and correct me if I'm wrong, the New England vernacular style. Now, I don't know if you know it, but like the A-frame house is a New England vernacular style, and I don't think that's what you intend at all. Living on Wells Road, one of the things that I find most charming about where we built our home, and Mr. Jordan lives on the road with me, is we have everything on our road. And I'd like to ask you, which is in the vernacular New England style. Bill has a working farm. There's folks who live in a small three-bedroom, one-story ranch house. There's a gentleman who lives in a one-room house. There are a couple of very expensive Greek Revival-type farmhouses. Some of us live in custom-designed solar-type homes that may appear to be New England from the road, but if you look at it from sitting in your canoe out on the Scarborough side of the marsh, look very contemporary. So I guess my point is I find New England vernacular style to be a very vague use of language, and I'm not sure what the intention was there, but either let's tighten it up with what you really meant, or let's not try to adjudicate what is, I think you were asking for something attractive. I'm not sure. So let's be a little clearer on that. My second point is,
if I can just speak to your first point, yes. Just to put everybody's mind at rest, the council unanimously decided that's gone.
Okay. So my second one, I hope, is the same thing. The second one was reference to the color.
That's gone too.
Thank you. I'll sit down.
Oh boy, this is getting easy. Who would like to be next? We're trying to make it easy for that five-person working group. Yeah, you're on a roll, Jane. Who would like to be next?
Good evening. My name is Alan Fishman. I'm not a resident of Cape Elizabeth, but I am speaking for some residents in that our company manages certain properties within the town boundaries, some of which, for example, would fall within the scenic protection zone. There are some questions as to, for example, why the entire length of Spurwink Avenue was considered for the scenic protection zone. Certain portions of it, at least, did not seem quite as significant as the view of various water views or two lights or those types of other views that were enumerated within the zone. Spurwink Avenue is a mixture of a few mostly residential uses, a few non-residential uses, and some of which have been master planned for more than may exist currently. And one of the questions is what the overlay of the scenic protection zone, how that would affect the possible future development of a previously approved plan. It appears that it might be somewhat confiscatory, and to that extent, I would say the owners of the property in that situation would be concerned. I guess those are our views. Thank
Great.
You.
Thank you for sharing that with us. Yes, sir.
Madam Chairperson, members of the council, my name is Jerry Amaro. I live at 444 Old Ocean House Road in Cape Elizabeth. I've lived in the Cape for 30 years. This is the first time I had the pleasure of being before the council. For many of those years, I avoided coming to the council because I didn't want Jane sitting up there in terror wondering what the hell I was going to say next. I am motivated.
Like
I am motivated to come here tonight, however, because of my concerns about contract zoning. I think it is a security issue. You've heard people who have addressed you this evening. People want to be secure in knowing that something isn't going to happen next door that is inconsistent with the zoning classification that applies to their properties. And even though there is confidence, and I've heard it expressed many times in the present council, present planning board, the present planner, they feel very uncomfortable having a blank check sitting out there to make a change that will result in a change in the zoning classification and deprive them of the protections that they think they have in their property. And I heard your consultant say tonight that contract zoning was often used to create more restrictions, more protections. But that's not what it says. If you look at the last paragraph of the ordinance as proposed, it says any any rezoning pursuant to this section that affects a shoreland area as identified in the ordinance shall demonstrate that it will provide substantially the same level of protection as the original district. Now, what does that mean? That means that unless you're in a shoreland district, the contract zoning can provide less or substantially less protections than your existing district. And that's what's causing the insecurity. And I don't think we need it. I think this town has great concerns about our environment and the comprehensive plan. And let's stick with it. Let's not create the impression that there's a blank check to change all of that. Thank you for the opportunity to express myself.
Thank you, Mr. Hammer.
My name is Jeff Alexander, and I live at 31 Reef Road. I came here tonight essentially just to hear what some other folks had to say, as well as the words from the council. I don't have any prepared remarks other than to reiterate, I guess, a few comments I think that were put so eloquently by Mr. Cogsall earlier, and that is that we have some boards here in the town right now who are very capable people and obviously want to do the best thing for the town. However, I think that the fear, as Mr. Cogsall had pointed out earlier, is that boards change, as he said, and 10, 20, 30 years from now, we're going to be living in a different world, and therefore we have to look forward accordingly. So I think that certainly the town council and the planning board would be rewarded, I think, by future generations by looking not only at the contract zoning, but the issues really at large in looking forward and trying to do what's best for the town long term, because obviously everyone lives in Cape Elizabeth because of the special characteristics that this town has, and all we need to do is go to our neighboring towns and see some mistakes that have been made in the past. So obviously I have confidence in these boards and that you'll do the right thing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Who would like to be next?
I have maybe a shot.
Can you tell us who you are and where you live, please?
Minnesota, but I live 515 Ocean House Road, but I really don't. I'm back toward the Great Pond, not on the Ocean House Road. And that's the area I'm concerned with, the Great Pond watershed. I've been on a committee or two in the past where we took a magic marker and drew a line and said, this was it. And I assume that's what you did with the Great Pond watershed. And for a fact, I know that this little community right here, all that water goes to Broad Cove, not Great Pond. And I live in that area, but not the area that I'm speaking of.
Right.
I'm on the edge. But I think it would be too bad to include that whole Pondview area with all those houses, and this Ocean House area up here, or Route 77, when that water certainly doesn't go the Great Pond. It crosses Route 77, then it crosses Wheeler Road, and then it goes down toward Maxwell's Pond, and crosses Two Lights Road, and ends up down in Broad Cove. It does not, and I think it would be an injustice to those people that live there. And they don't, even if there are some people living there now, they probably don't realize that. But I just thought it would be too bad for them to be in that zone when they don't belong there.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. Who would like to be next? Is there anybody else who would like to speak? About the proposed zoning ordinance or the proposed zoning map? You're sure? Okay, thank you very much. I'm just going to wait for them.
No. I ain't sure as this is enough to delete all these, revise these, and I hope. I hope that they get in line. I'm going to omit these tonight. Are they?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Sounds like you're getting ready to.
We've got another public hearing.
That's what I told you about.
On the wetlands provisions.
You want to
tag team council?
You want to take 5 minutes?
No, let's go.
Let's take 2 minutes and, yes.
I got just enough time.
Yes, you do, Counselor.
You know, Jim.
We're taking a 2 minute break. Council will take a 2 minute break.
The street past Broad Cove Road to the 19 way.
Councilors who want to make motions at this time. Council McGinty, were you looking ready?
Oh, I'm wondering if there's any sentiment to deal with the contract zoning issue tonight, or if the councilors would prefer to put it off and think about it. I mean, I know where I stand on the issue. I'm willing to move forward tonight, but if I'm not sure what the council's consensus is and where we want to move with the entire ordinance.
All right, let me frame it in the context that a lot of work has gone on to the entirety of this document. There are components of it, however, that can be removed and vote. Any component can be removed and voted on separately. I think this is one component that can be removed, voted on separately, and there is no significant impact to any other part of the zoning, proposed zoning ordinance. I'm looking at the consultant and the planner to see if that's a correct statement. And he's shaking his head both ways. Please go to the microphone.
Yes. For the council and members of the public, the contract zoning is in Article 11, and essentially Article 11 is freestanding. While there are some interrelations to other references to other parts and procedures, to the best of my knowledge, standing here tonight, there's nothing that relates the other way. So if you were to delete it or separate it, I don't think there's any consequences at all.
Great. Thank you very much. Councilor Groff.
I might be able to act on it tonight, but I just have one question first, and I think it's partly because I've only been a town councilor for a year, and obviously wasn't in on the initial meetings of the committee when contract zoning first came about, the concept came about, and then how it got in. And I am curious to have somebody on the ZORC committee inform me or educate me as to what the initial thought was of why we needed contract zoning and why we have this contract zoning provision in ZORC. What was the thought process at the time? And that might help me then understand if things have changed or just what has happened as to why there's such overwhelming negative attitudes towards or toward this provision at this time.
Thank you. Mr. McGovern?
Just very briefly, the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee was charged with implementing the recommendations of the comprehensive plan, as well as with just providing general update language of the ordinance. This actually did not, the germination of the proposal was not from the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, it was from the Comprehensive Planning Committee. I don't know for sure why the Comprehensive Planning Commission did it, but my sense is that it was being done in other communities, and in sometimes at times was felt to be a useful tool in order to protect some of the resources of the community. I think that was the thinking of the town at the time.
What was the discussion of what things could be protected in Keep Elizabeth if, in fact, we had a contract zoning provision? What was the discussion at the time?
Councilor Cogswell.
As part of our charge to implement the comprehensive plan, one of the recommendations was to consider this contract zoning. And as the manager said, it has been used. It is present in lots of other ordinances. And so it was more or less added to our ordinance because it was, quote, something to be considered and because it's used in other places. It was not really studied. We didn't come up with any scenarios. We didn't do any real evaluation. It was just sort of presented as a planning tool. And we didn't spend any time really going through all the other steps that we did with some of the other ordinances, with the ARB proposals, the RB, or in particular the scenic. So it was just there. And obviously, it probably should have been studied a little more thoroughly.
Were there any strong advocates for, at the time,
no.
This was added?
No.
Okay. The council did receive one letter advocating contract zoning from a member of the committee. That's been, out of all the letters received, of which there have been, you know, 20 or more, it was just one letter from one member of the committee.
And actually, he paraphrased saying that it could be a good planning tool, because that's the way it was presented to us, but that he didn't support it 100%. He said there could be concerns.
Thank you.
Councilor George.
I was there, and I didn't, and I'll say now that I understand it a little better than I did then, but I felt at the time, and I said it at the time a couple of times, I think that was went in there, and it was beyond the charge that the committee had to rewrite the ordinance. It's something that was added in there, but I was overruled and said I was wrong in thinking in that direction. I still believe it.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor McGinty.
Will you entertain a motion, Madam Chair?
Sir, yes, I will, sir.
I move that Article 11, Contract Zoning, Section 19-11-1, Contract Zoning, be removed from the proposed zoning ordinance.
Second.
Thank you. Further discussion? Councilor.
I would just like to reiterate what the chairman of the ZORC committee, Councilor Coggeshall, said. And I think when we did talk about this, and maybe for Joe's benefit, it was considered just a zoning tool, and just that. It was presented in a very positive light that it may be something that we could use somewhere in the future, and it wasn't anything that we looked at to be used at any particular location throughout the town, but that it was a potential positive tool to be used. And I'd just like to say that.
Thank you. I need to say that I'm not going to vote in favor of this. I'm doing this because of the success I have seen contract zoning have. I wish we could have, in retrospect, there are a lot of things I always wish. This is one of those sections that I wished had been taken out and studied more thoroughly. I refuse, however, to hold the rest of the zoning proposed zoning ordinance hostage to something that is not going to be favorable with the majority of the council. That's one reason I entertained the motion tonight. I would have entertained it next month if it had happened then. But because of my deep belief in the planning profession, my deep belief in the integrity of the citizens of this town who vote for competent and capable representatives on the council, those representatives then appoint very capable planning board members. I do not have some of the fears that I've heard expressed tonight, but that is because I have more familiarity than a lot of people do with contract zoning. I know that's not a popular decision for a lot of people to hear somebody on the council state tonight, but that is why I'm going to be voting the way I am. Councilor Cogswell.
I guess I'm disappointed that you wouldn't even give a further look at this particular part of the ordinance, that you wouldn't recommend that we take some of the recommendations from the public about reviewing it and tightening up some of the criteria, that you're just going to vote against anything at all. Just leave it there. Isn't that what you're saying?
I'm saying that everybody had equal chance to draft, propose a motion this evening. That's not what the motion before the board is, before the council is right now. Counselor Jordan?
I don't understand why we can't drop it from this and review it. I ain't really 100% in favor of throwing it out in the wastebasket, but I think it should be looked at, but I don't think it should go into the ordinance, and it's one of these things that get in there, and then it's damn hard to make a move to change.
Yes, sir. My understanding of the motion on the floor is that it is to drop this with no further study. Is that correct, Councilor McGinty?
That's my motion.
Thank you. Anybody else? All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 6-1. Thank you. That reduces the paperwork. Saves a tree eventually, I'm sure. All right.
I'd say you miss.
What is the wish of the council with the remainder of what we have before us for the new zoning ordinance proposal? Bearing in mind that we've asked a group of folks to look at the scenic provisions for us by and have that in their recommendation in place by next month's council meeting. Councilor Cogsell.
Yes, tonight I would like us to consider the proposals that were sent to us through the town planner from, I've got to find these first here. All the color sheets. We had asked at our workshop that our ordinance advisor prepare some recommendations. So, number one, to either delete everything, wait for the recommendations from this committee that's just been appointed, or have a very strong policy statement. We did hear a couple of comments tonight, hoping that we would at least maintain in place a strong policy statement until we receive the recommendations of this advisory group. Having worked on ordinances for so many years, I seriously doubt that they'd be able to come forward in this short period of time unless they're at all familiar with the process and drafting ordinances without being educated as to what's involved in time for us to go through the final vote in May. If we have a policy statement or retrain as one of the recommendations here, maybe I need Mark to help me with this. The new purpose statement that is in our on page 103 that was proposed, where the term managed is substituted. Mark, may we ask Mark to go over those three alternatives for us?
Certainly. Or
Maureen.
Perhaps Ms. Amira. She's on the blue page 103, I believe.
103. That begins the scenic overlay. We have all these different colors, and I'm not sure.
What right. Page numbers are up at the top right.
What I tried to do is, if you start with the yellow book and you've had a couple of amendments in your package, you probably had some white pages, which are the Fort Williams amendments and the wetlands amendments. And I thought, just to kind of keep everything separate, we started into colors. So if you look at your package, you've got blue and green, and those are an either-or option. At your workshop last week, there was discussion about doing some kind of a placeholder amendment for the scenic area districts. So you've got option one, which is to wait for the scenic working group to come up with a recommendation. So you don't have any color for that. Option two is the blue section. And what is that? That is doing is, I believe what we're doing there is we're leaving all the districts in place, but we're making them advisory. So they're not mandatory. It's something that if someone had to come to the planning board for some kind of review, this is something that could be considered, but they would not be required to meet those requirements. The third alternative, which is the green alternative, is that you would basically just keep a purpose statement that says it's the intent that the scenic areas that are identified in the visual assessment study be preserved. Now, most of the pages you have there are replacement pages for your yellow book. If you were to go with option two, then you could take all the replacement pages, you'd see what would be deleted out of the ordinance. If you went with option three, you'd see the other things that would be deleted. Any questions?
Counselor Reed, you look perplexed.
We were just given this tonight immediately before the meeting. I will not be acting or commenting on these changes, but I do very much appreciate the effort. I don't feel prepared or have enough time to digest some of these changes at this short notice. I'm sorry.
Thank you. Anybody else? Counselor Linnell?
Yeah, I'd just echo what Counselor Reed just said.
Thank you. Counselor Cogswell?
Then I move that this consideration be continued until next month, and it would be part of the public hearing in May for final adoption. The two alternatives of maintaining the districts as strictly advisory, and the other one would be just the purpose statement. And that will give us a chance to look them both over.
Along with whatever the working group.
If that comes to time, yes.
Mm-hmm.
That was a motion.
That was a motion, though. That's what I thought. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Further discussion?
Hey, the clarification.
Yes, Mr. McGovern.
Did the motion include the provision on the pink pages relating to the 20,000-square-foot lot in a Town Center Core sub-district? And did the motion include the language in the yellow pages which strikes gravel extraction as a permitted use in a BB zone?
I'm just dealing with wetlands now. I thought we could deal with these others separately.
Deal with what?
You're dealing
just
with
the
scenic overlays.
Scenic overlay.
Oh, okay. Is there anybody who needs further clarification or discussion?
Yeah, I'm lost.
What I'm hearing, Councilor,
you've got so many different sections here. You've got to go blue, green, yellow, orange.
We're just dealing with only scenic overlay at the moment.
Yeah, I understand that part of it.
And you can digest over the next month the blue and the green proposals and perhaps something that the working committee brings forward. But at least this will still be available for consideration.
So it's all, as I should say in my language, it will all be laid out for a change if you want it at the next meeting?
Yes.
Correct.
You're not locking me into any specific part of it.
I'd never lock you in, Counselor.
Oh, you wouldn't. I won't go any farther than that. I'll move.
All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 7-0. The blue and the green live on.
We're going back to school. That's what we're doing. You know, young grades with colors.
Councilor Cogswell?
Yes, on the, I don't know if how the council feels on the permitted uses within the BB district. We did discuss this at a workshop, and this just reflects what the recommendations were, and I thought we had a consensus that we did want to eliminate subsurface geological conditions of gravel extraction from being allowed in that district.
Are we on the yellow page?
We're on the yellow page. Going to the yellow.
Oh.
This is when we find out if anybody's colorblind. Councilor Cogswell.
So I'll move that we accept the correction in the BB district as presented and discussed previously.
Second.
Thank you. This is what the council discussed at a workshop last week. I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
It's all.
Only last week.
Only last week, yes. It was bringing into consistency with the way the BB zone line has been drawn, I believe.
The use is currently.
That was what the basic change was. And as presented, gravel extraction is not going to be a permitted use in the BB zone. The BB zone no longer includes an existing gravel extraction operation. Mr. McGovern?
Just to clarify, it never did include
Right.
the BB zone, a gravel extraction operation. At one point, it was suggested to include it in this proposal. It's now being recommended that it not, but it's never been allowed in the BB zone.
It's just catching the language up with previous decisions and the drawing of the lines on the map. Councilor Jordan?
There's something that just kind of, as I glanced down through this just now, and on page 85 in the yellow, the following non-residential uses: A, storage and selling of farm, dairy, orchard, or forest products for retail sales shall be permitted. How about, does that mean you could sell seedlings or plants or stuff like that, or not?
Yes. Yes.
You can, because it don't say it, you can do it. Is that what you're telling me?
It says you can sell farm products. Seedling grown on a farm. A seedling's a farm product. It's
okay. I won't go any farther with it, but I think if my neighbor didn't like something I was doing, he'd pick me up on it, and I'd have to fight for it.
Are you doing this in the BB district, sir?
Am I doing it? No, but I'm not the only one who's in Cape Elizabeth.
No, I'm saying that what we're referring to right now is only the BB, the proposed BB district.
Yeah, I understand that.
Okay.
I understand that.
Okay.
I think there's some people that live there.
Okay. Any other comment? All right, we have a motion and a second on it. All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 7-0. So that change is adopted. Who would like to deal with the pink pages?
I'll let somebody else move down. I don't want to monopolize things. Let's see.
Well, yes, while we're playing catch-up, the manager is graciously offering to give an explanation.
Yes, the town council has heard some public comment earlier through this process that there's a portion of the town center district which essentially includes the portion between the Thomas Memorial Library and the public safety building. And that under the earlier proposal, it was only permitted to allow a residential, an additional residential structure there if the lot was at least 80,000 square feet. This proposal changes it so that you could establish a new residential lot in that section of the town center district if it only had 20,000 square feet. That's the proposed change.
Thank you. Councilor Groff.
And just so I understand things, this only has to do with the school side of the road, right?
And only the school side of the road between the public safety building and the Thomas Memorial Library, not all the way down to Fowler Road.
That is more precisely shown on the third pink page on the map. It's the area that the three arrows are pointing to.
Madam Chair.
Councilor McGinty.
I move that we approve the changes to the Town Center District, Section 19-6-4, as reflected in the pink pages.
Second.
Thank you, Councilors. Councilor Cogsell.
I believe we should be setting this for public hearing and not just adopting it, because we have not had a public hearing on this, and it is a zoning ordinance change. And also a question of process. Mm-hmm. Usually the planning board needs to make recommendations on any zoning ordinance changes, and this probably should also be forwarded to them for their comments.
What is the wish of the council? Mr. McGovern?
If I might explain, I think in approving the earlier pages here, you're essentially taking the same action that, as I understand it, that you're proposing for these pages. And that is to set all of these to public hearing for a final vote at your May meeting. And because this is part of the entire new zoning ordinance, and all these amendments are, and they've all gone through this process, the intent was not to go back to the old process of referring them back to the planning board. This whole ordinance was reviewed by the planning board, by the zoning ordinance committee, and any amendments being offered at this time to in any section of this ordinance My understanding was it was the desire of the council that it be considered part of this package that would ultimately be voted on as part of this ordinance and this process.
Councilor Cogswell, would you like to explain why you want to separate this one out to go back to the planning board?
The manager made reference to these other proposals that we're going to be hearing. They have all gone through the whole process and the zoning planning board review and recommendations. What we are proposing is lesser, is less than what is in the draft of the zoning ordinance rewrite report. This is more, it's not a de minimis change, it's a much more significant kind of change that has not had any kind of review by either body. Where we can set it for public hearing, but I still think because it is a zoning ordinance change, we need to have some input from the planning board.
Okay. Councilor Reed.
I have a question process. I served on the town center planning zone, and I believe with all my heart that the change that we're making now is consistent with what the committee thought we had included. And my understanding is that when that language came out of the town center zone, it was absent of any language regarding the lot size, and that's why the 80,000 went in there. I think I spoke at that public hearing against the 80,000 square foot figure at that time, but I was just wondering how it got to be 80,000 other than what I just described.
Councilor, do you have a record?
I saw nothing in the town center plan report that had any specific size lot recommended at all. And we sent parts of that to the planning board for them to draft the ordinance language, which we now have in our current zoning ordinances. Perhaps we need to have our town planner come forward and perhaps answer your question. And maybe our town attorney wants tell us if it's more of a de minimis change or if it really is a significant enough change to have reviewed by the planning board also.
If we could first have Councilor Linnell and then we'll ask for assistance from the audience.
I remember when we voted on this, some of this language a couple of years ago, and I can remember saying that I was concerned that the 80,000 square feet and so forth was in there, and I asked that we delay voting on the ordinance for simply 1 month so we could study the question then. And the response, I recall, was that we should go ahead and vote for this and then we could come back and change it later. So to me, it's later. So I'd like to change it now.
Okay, thank you. Ms. O'Meara, could you give us a historical perspective on this, please?
The Town Center Planning Committee met for about 18 months, and they wrote the whole plan, and before they were done, the recommendation was that because they had spent more time looking at the Town Center zone in such focused detail than any other group had ever before and probably ever would again, that they should take a stab at drafting a zoning amendment. And that's what they did, and that zoning amendment is included in the back of the town center plan, which you all have a copy of. But the thing is, you need to keep in mind that they did not draft it down to the last detail. It did not have a minimum lot size for residential uses. And what happened is, after that report was forwarded to the council and it was accepted by the council, they took the different parts of the recommendations and distributed them out to groups, and the planning board got the zoning amendment, and they spent a lot of time working on that. Their biggest addition was putting in the whole series of design guidelines. But between the planning board and then the ordinance committee, there were much more tightening up of the actual minimum lot size requirements, minimum lot size for apartment requirements. A lot of those things were added through the end of the process.
Thank you. Mr. Leahy?
The zoning ordinance is what speaks to the issue, asking that the council, before they adopt any amendments, have a planning board recommendation. I would think that there'd probably be a lot of changes from the last time the planning board saw this, based upon all the meetings I heard discussed tonight. So I really don't think that a change of that nature would have to go back to the planning board. I think if you did that, be back and forth to the planning board with any changes that this council makes to the last draft that the planning board saw and recommended to you. So I don't think it has to go back and forth with each change. So I don't see that you have to do that unless you vote that you want to do that.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor Groff?
Well, I'm concerned if it did go back to the planning board, would it catch up to be able to be voted on? I mean, I'm not in a hurry. Well, I don't care whether we do it tonight or we do it the next meeting. What I care about is it gets to be part of the package that we vote on at the end in May. Now, my question is, it's much more practical. I would not be for sending this to have anybody else comment on it if, in fact, that will not make it right for a public hearing on schedule with everything else and on a vote with everything else. And if I can be assured that sending it to the planning board will not derail this provision and we can still vote on everything at one time in May, that's fine. If you can't give me that assurance, then I'll defer to the town attorney and let's vote on it tonight.
If we could have a feel for the planning board's schedule, Mr. Mayor?
I guess the question is whether you're sending it to the planning board as a zoning amendment or if you're sending it to the planning board for advice. If you're sending it to the planning board for advice, they certainly would have time at the April workshop to discuss it and possibly actually have formal adopted recommendations for their April meeting.
When is their April meeting? The April workshop?
I believe the workshop is April 1st and the meeting is April 15th.
That is after the council meeting in April.
Well, if you want informal comments after the workshop, the thing is the board is prohibited from making any decisions at workshops. So depends on how formal, if you want to call it a zoning amendment, then they're required to hold a public hearing and there's a certain amount of time involved in that, so you're really looking at April and May.
Thank you. Councilor Cogsall?
If it's just for advice, we can set this, as we have it before us tonight, for public hearing in May, which we were going to do anyway, but still not, you know, avoid going through getting their advice. I'm just, you and I have always been so concerned about process all these years, and this thing's taken 2.5 years. Just getting advice from them, I don't think, is going to derail it.
Councilor Groff?
If it's set for May.
So if I understand things correctly, we're not treating this as a zoning board, as a zoning amendment, as an amendment. We are simply saying that we're deferring, we're setting this up for a public hearing, and if in fact the planning board wants to give us advice before the public hearing, fine. If they don't, then this will be at the public hearing. This will be a part and parcel of everything else that's at the public hearing, and we can vote on it along with everything else. Is that what we're doing?
That would be the intent of my motion.
Okay. That's fine.
It's in case of what he said.
And Debbie's got it all written down.
I was talking to Chairman LeBron.
Do you want to elaborate on the motion?
What's the date we're going to set this for public hearing? Is it going to be May or April? That's
May 5th.
For May 5th?
You can set it for public hearing. What I'm hearing, well, the sense I have is that there will be, we can have more public hearing, more council discussion at the council's April meeting, which is April 14th. The council right now has two meetings scheduled in May, May 5th and May 12th.
When were we going to vote on the total ordinance?
The sense I have is that vote would be in May.
May 12th?
It could be the 5th or the 12th.
If he's setting it for public hearing, he has to know.
It's whatever the council desires. We can be prepared for either date.
It's preferable to set it for May 5th, and then if something goes awry, then you have the fallback position of May 12th.
Okay, let's set this for hearing on May 5th, 7:30 at Town Hall, and send it to the Planning Board for comments and advice.
that's a motion.
That's a motion.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. That takes care of all the colored pages. Okay. Did we have a motion on the rest of the yellow book?
No, we haven't.
No. Okay.
I don't think it's...
Still like to know the council's desire on the rest of the story? And is the rest of the new zoning ordinance and the new zoning map? Do you want to set your public hearing on May 5th?
I would move to set the public hearing on May 5th, both the zoning map and the zoning ordinance.
All right. Any discussion?
Second. Are you going to second?
Second. Thank you.
That's May 5th?
May 5th. Mm-hmm. That's the night we're also scheduled to adopt budget. Mr. McGovern.
I have a question. Would this council have any objection to staff reviewing the exact confines of the watershed for Great Pond?
Please do that. Okay. It would be the zoning maps as presented with a potential revision to the Great Pond Watershed Overlay District based on topography verification. Mm-hmm. Right. I'd like to ask if staff has any concerns with the motion on the floor. I'd ask the planner and the consultant, and then I'd ask the manager.
My one request would be that you now have three sets of amendments in color, plus two in white and black, and my only request would be that at some point, a minimum of 2 weeks, preferably 3 weeks before the public hearing, the council hold a workshop and review a final draft document and agree that staff has done exactly what they expected staff to do.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan, I saw you.
No, I think Maureen kind of hit on what I was interested in, because I don't want to come in to the final vote and try to push little bitty changes and say it's okay, because mm-hmm. I will not vote for it. I've been caught in that before.
Okay. We will have an item on the April agenda for council discussion. We'll have a public hearing also, so if the public wants to make further comments on the proposed zoning ordinance, the proposed zoning map, they will have a full chance to do so. The council will have a chance to discuss it in April, see what the status is, and either at that point or a workshop following, sometime after the April meeting, the council will nail down the language that it will have at public hearing on May 5th. We have to do that, as Ms. O'Meara said, preferably 3 weeks in advance to meet all of our legal requirements for noticing, which means by April 14th, basically, we need to have it all together. So at the April meeting, what we finalize then looks like that's what will go to public.
It's not exactly our legal requirements. I mean, we're meeting our legal requirements by having these options. We're really doing it as a matter of efficiency mm-hmm. for the council to have in front of them as to what they're actually going to vote on. But I don't think it has anything to do with legal requirements.
You're right. We've met the legal requirements this evening, I believe. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I just want to make sure I understood you very clearly in April. You do want an item in April to revisit this, but
yes.
you use the term public hearing. But I just want to clarify that what you're talking about is an opportunity for public comment, but not a legal public hearing
right.
with all the noticing requirements
right.
thereof.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Ms. O'Meara?
Just one thing I wanted to address what you talked about in terms of a legal requirement. The notices have to go out 2 weeks in advance, and this community is very interested. I've gotten a lot of phone calls, and the reason I asked for the 3 weeks is it gives me enough time to make sure I have exactly what you want, and then to make whatever copies we need to so that the public has available well before the meeting anything that you're going to be discussing.
Thank you. All right. Any further discussion on Council McGinty's motion?
What's the question?
All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. We have another public hearing this evening on proposed amendments to the current zoning ordinance, those amendments dealing with wetland provisions. Ms. O'Meara, you doing our introduction for us on this? Good, thank you. This is on white paper.
I only used the colored paper the one time.
It was very helpful.
The proposed revisions that you have before you were forwarded by the planning board and then reviewed by the ordinance committee, and there are a series of what I'm going to very briefly summarize as six amendments to the current wetlands regulations. As an aside, these exact same amendments have been incorporated into the new draft ordinance as well. Just going down very quickly, number one, permit landscaping fences. There was an applicant who unfortunately had to get a wetland special permit to install a fence in their yard, and this would make it no longer a requirement that you'd have to get a special permit. You could do it as of right. Number two, reduce the wetland buffer for official playing fields. What this does is it says that if you're within a critical wetland buffer, but if you're at least 100 feet away from the wetland edge, you can install an official vegetated playing field with a special permit or a wetland permit from the planning board. Number three is to lift the mandatory 250-foot buffer around a portion of Great Pond. If I can just show you the map right here, you can see that there's kind of a heavy line around Great Pond, and it drops off in this area. This is the area where you would no longer have a mandatory 250-foot buffer. You would be eligible for reductions under the other sections of the ordinance. Doesn't mean you'd get the reductions, but you would be eligible at least to apply for them. Number four, revise for clarity, topographical change. The current ordinance says there are four conditions under which you can get the 250-foot buffer reduced down to 100 feet. One of them is if the development site is topographically distinct from the site of the wetland. This is an existing provision in the ordinance, and we just rewrote it because there were some issues with what exactly that meant, especially as it relates to whether a road is considered a topographical feature that divides a wetland from a development site. Under number five, allow expansions located in the wetland buffer. What was done here is there was some greater latitude provided for non-conforming structures, basically residential structures in critical wetland buffers, to allow them greater expansion opportunities. In particular, starting at the bottom of the page under number three, what this now says is if you own a home and it's more than 100 feet away from the wetland edge, you can expand 50 feet in any direction as long as you don't cross over that 100-foot imaginary boundary. And there's still some limits on how much your expansion can go, but it allows people a little bit more flexibility on where they can put their addition. Under number five, we also changed a little bit what we allow for decks. In order to make it more consistent with the previous policy I just described, it didn't make sense to regulate decks more strictly than you were going to be regulating brand new additions. And number six, there's been a lot of talk about need for an appeals procedure for the wetlands provisions, and what this does is it explicitly states that you can apply for a variance to build in a critical wetland area as long as you're not expanding beyond 40%. Any questions?
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for Ms. O'Meara? Councilor McGinty?
Could you just clarify on five that this is for existing buildings only? This does not involve new structures?
Absolutely nothing involving new structures. It's non-conforming activities, and you just don't have the above paragraphs, so you only got the stuff that changes, but it only applies to existing structures.
Ms. O'Meara, if this is voted on by the council tonight, when does it become effective?
I defer to the town clerk, but I believe that's 30 days.
30. Thank you. Councilor Cogsell.
I have a question to the town clerk. If we wanted to make this an emergency ordinance, we would need, what, a 7-0 vote? Is that maybe Mr. McGowan?
Well, first of all, you would need to declare an emergency and have an emergency preamble.
So we didn't do that.
And then you'd need two-thirds vote of the council. The one issue that's pending on this, you know, we've worked out issues with the planning board. Is that what you're getting at? So that you know, there isn't a concern, because they know the, it's been enacted, and generally, they will entertain things within 30 days after something's been enacted, provided it's been enacted. They won't take final action, though, within that 30 days, but that's not expected to be any problem.
Thank you. I'm sorry. This is a public hearing. It is now time for the council to take comments from anybody who wishes to address this.
Yes, my name is Fred Brown. I live on 16 Fenway Road. My house definitely falls within this area everybody's been talking about just now. And I came in, oh, I don't know, a couple months ago, seeking to get a permission to extend on the garage. And since then, I've been sitting there going, blah, 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 with all these rules and regulations. I keep hearing about extending ball fields and wetlands. A guy across the street from me can put on all kinds of additions, 50-foot additions on his house, but yet I can't put an 8-foot addition on my garage. This don't seem just right. I've lived here 27 years. In the 27 years, the only thing that's happened has been more and more and more restrictions to what I can do on my property. I please wish you people would think of the people that are living here now and have paid taxes in this town all this time and are being told they can't do anything with their property. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Is there anybody else who would like to address this item?
Yes, my name is Charles Pillsbury, and I live at 45 Bowery Beach Road. And last, I believe, around September, I came in looking to get a permit to build a garage, and was informed that I'm in wetland, and went to the procedure that you have to follow to either determine that you are actually in a wetland, because I disputed it. And got a hold of Woodlot Alternatives, which is a company that is on a list that you provided me, and at my expense, they came down, measured the property, and informed me that I'm over 344 feet from a wetland. But the thing that bothered me the most was that in the new map you have, you've come out to 77 down Fowler Road and a few other zigs and zags, but nobody has ever, from the town, from what I understand, it's Army Corps engineers have done the original survey to determine the wetland. And it affects a lot of people around that area, but it puts an unnecessary expense